New Testament scholar Bart Ehrman says that the author of Acts didn't know the Apostle Paul. Ehrman writes that the author of Acts is simply claiming to be a traveling companion of Paul's and therefore unusually well-suited to give a true account of Paul's message and mission, but he almost certainly was not a companion of Paul's. On the one hand, he was writing long after Paul and his companions were dead. Scholars usually date Acts to around 85 CE or so, over two decades after Paul's death. On the other hand, he seems to be far too poorly informed about Paul's theology and missionary activities to have been someone with first-hand knowledge. Well, Dr. Ehrman, allow me to introduce you to the 18th century sailor James Smith. Smith wrote a forgotten but invaluable book titled The Voyage and Shipwreck of St. Paul. Here I'll be quoting from an entry written in the Library of Historical Apologetics by Dr. Tim McGrew. Dr. McGrew gives a brief sample of evidence found in this book, and you'll want to stick around to the end of the video because I'm going to let you know where you can download the book for absolutely free. McGrew writes, "At first glance, a Victorian sailor might seem like an unlikely candidate to make a contribution to the study of the New Testament, but Smith was more than just a sailor. He was also a keen student of ancient literature. His knowledge both of geology and of archaeology was considerable, and on the subject of ships of the ancients, he was a recognized authority. From 1839 to 1846, Smith was abroad and he wintered successfully at Gibraltar, Lisbon, and Malta. It was his residence at Malta during the winter of 1844 through 45 that prompted the investigations that led to the research and publication of The Voyage and Shipwreck of St. Paul, which first appeared in 1848 when Smith was in his 60s. Smith argues persuasively that the shipwreck described in Acts 27 through 28 took place at the island of Malta, but he does much more than that. He shows by a minute analysis of the text of Acts, by a very careful comparison with other descriptions of the Mediterranean shipwrecks by Josephus and Lucian, and by a wide range of nautical information about prevailing winds, soundings, and coastlines, that Luke's account of the voyage and shipwreck bears numerous marks of authenticity. An argument like this, built from numerous details, can't be compressed into a summary, but it can be illustrated by a handful of instances that all point in the same direction. For starters, Luke gives only a few disjointed allusions to the distance and direction of the storm-driven voyage from Cauda to Malta, but they work out well enough to enable a sailor to reconstruct a logbook of the ship's course and speed. Tacking 8 points to the north as close to the wind Euroquillo as was safe would bring them 476 miles in a little over 13 days, assuming a rate of drifting of 1.5 miles per hour. And indeed, on the 14th night, which we read in Acts 27:27, they arrived just a few miles from the island. Bolisantes, a term found in Acts 27:28, is the correct nautical term for taking soundings, and the numbers given correspond to a plausible period between their becoming aware of the breaking foam at the rocky point of Cora, about 20 fathoms, and their becoming aware of the breakers on the precipitous shoreline ahead, about 15 fathoms. In Acts 28:7, Luke refers to Publius as the first man of the island. Smith gives inscriptional evidence showing that this indeed was an official title in Malta. But he does much more than this. Not only was the narrator of the voyage and shipwreck an eyewitness, he was also, Smith shows, a landsman. In several places, Luke gives an accurate account of the actions of the crew without giving a full account, sometimes without giving any account, of why these actions were necessary. Again, this argument cannot be compressed, but a few examples will illustrate it. The phrase chalisantes discios in Acts 27:17 shows both Luke's accuracy of observation, they were taking down all superfluous rigging, and arguably his lack of appreciation of the navigational necessity of this for laying the ship on a starboard track with its right side pointed into the wind. The crisis of despair that we read about in Acts 27:20 may have come when the crew realized they probably missed Sicily and could never survive in the vain hope of reaching the Tunisian coast intact. Luke notes this despair, but gives the reader no indication of what might cause it. Casting anchors from the stern that we read about in Acts 27:29 was the proper emergency action to take in the circumstances, preventing the ship from swinging around broadside to the waves and being smashed stern first on the rocks. Luke reports the action without showing any awareness of how unusual it was or why it was necessary. Finally, once they were ready to try to run the ship ashore at daylight, it was imperative, as we read in Acts 27:38, to throw out all the remaining weight, no longer necessary for ballast, in order to have the best chance of running the ship bow first as high as possible on the beach. Once again, Luke reports the action, but he gives neither the reason that the grain was retained earlier, nor the reason that it was now thrown overboard. Another point of interest along this line is picked up by classical historian Colin Hemmer. The report of that voyage notes that they sailed along Crete, hugging the coast, but afterward, a violent wind called Euryquilo came rushing down from the island. That's in Acts 27, 13-14. Luke's report is also validated by well-established winds over Crete from the northeast, which are strongest as the holiday nears. In Acts 27:16, the ship is described as being blown toward the island of Cotta. It's impressive to note that Cotta is more than 20 miles west-southwest of where the storm likely hit the travelers in the Bay of Massara. A northeaster should have carried them precisely here, and this is not the sort of information that could be inferred without having been carried there by the wind yourself. The ancient historians and geographers found it nearly impossible to properly locate islands this far out. Hemmer notes that in the places where we can compare, Luke fares much better than the Encyclopedia's Pliny, who might be regarded as the foremost first century example of such a source. Pliny places Cotta opposite of Hieropytna, some 90 miles too far east. Even Ptolemy, who offers a reckoning of latitude and longitude, makes a serious dislocation to the northwest, putting Cotta too near the western end of Crete, in a position which would not suit the unsteady narrative of our text. It is impossible to overestimate the value of such historical material. In his work, Smith makes it beyond the shadow of a doubt that the author of these latter sections of Acts accompanied Paul on his long voyage to Rome, and by so doing, he lends Luke a great deal of credit as a historian. This goes against Ehrman's assertions that the author of Acts is merely spinning a good yarn. In the description down below, you can download Smith's book for absolutely free from the Google Play Store. It's public domain, and so it's available for everybody. Thank you so much for watching. If you found this video helpful, please be sure to like, comment, and share.